This morning's scripture lesson is from Micah 6:6-8. Please listen to the word of God. What God requires. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has told you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you, but to do justice, and to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Lord God, we stand here in the footsteps of your prophets, Jeremiah, Isaiah, Ezekiel, and Micah. We stand here in the footsteps of your Son, Jesus Christ. We stand here in the footsteps of great men and women, like Harry Tubman and Martin Luther King. May we be worthy of that legacy. May the words I preach today be inspiring to your people. May I be able to stir their hearts and help to bring about justice. Help to love kindness. And may we all humbly walk with you, O Lord, in your holy name. Amen. So it's Martin Luther King. So Martin Luther King Day is coming up. And with all of the, well, in the past few years, there's been a lot of racial controversy in this country. Seems like it's getting worse instead of better. And so I thought when I was going to do this sermon, I'd start out by sort of doing a lesson on racism, talking about that divide, and shining a sermonic spotlight into this chasm that seems to be widening. But as I started to do that, I realized that this is a huge subject that would require a whole sermon series or an in-depth Bible study. And also, I don't know how right it would be as being a white guy to be telling a mainly white congregation about all of the ins and outs of racial discrimination in this country. And so I started to reflect on it. I thought, but you know what? I don't need to talk about racial discrimination to talk about discrimination and injustice. Because as a white person, I've faced a lot of discrimination and prejudice and oppression in my own particular way. And I think actually talking about, I don't know what you want to call it, blindism instead of racism or something, being discriminated against because you're disabled American with a disability, helps to maybe draw out some of the deeper questions about prejudice and racism that exist. Because the racist always tries to justify their discrimination by saying, well, that person is not as intelligent, not as physically strong, not as, you know, they're lazy, or whatever that might be. But we know scientifically that there is no difference between a black person, a white person, an Asian person, besides the color of their skin. A little bit more melatonin. That's it. One person is in no way inferior to another. But when it comes to someone who's disabled, the argument changes a little bit. Because in some ways, my eyes are more inferior than your eyes. disabled person might not be as physically strong or as mentally capable or something like that. So it changes the question. It really points out, well, are we still all human and should we all still be treated the same? How do you do this? Those questions become more vivid. I think part of it, of course, though, is also that I am not as if that a blind person, given the right adaptations, is not inferior. So someone who can read a book is definitely better off than someone who's blind. But if the blind person can read Braille, shoot, they can read a book in the dark. So it depends on whether the adaptations work, to bring about those questions of what does it mean to be inferior or whatnot. So I thought I'd share with you some of the experiences I've had. Now I can tell you, when I was reflecting on the different experiences I've had, I was in a chemistry class once and the teacher said that the experiments were too dangerous for me to handle. So instead his idea was that I would learn, now remember the blind guy, I would learn by observing. another example that I thought about telling you about, I went for an interview as a chaplain intern in New York, and I didn't get the job. And I was fretting. What was it? Was it my qualifications? Was it did I not present myself well? Well, I later found out it was because when I came in, I went to sit down, I tried to stumble a little bit when I was going to sit down. And it didn't matter that I had a master's, two master's degrees, that I was working at the largest hospital in New York City. But that little stumble was, well, he's blind, I don't think he's a good job. Now, probably the biggest, one of the most eye-opening situations that's happened to me recently was I got a job that was kind of out in the middle of nowhere. It was a good job, but I needed transportation. Now, fortunately, there is a disabled bus service called Access Link, by the way, which anybody can sign up for. It's a good service, Access Link. That was able to drive me to work and drive me home. Unfortunately, because they didn't want disabled people taking advantage of this system, the regulations made it so they couldn't drop me off exactly at my work. They actually had to drive past my work, and they dropped me off about a mile down the road. And I had to walk a mile on a two-lane highway with no sidewalks to get to work. Now, I wanted to kind of fight against this, protest, to seek justice. I mentioned this to the work people, but because I was a part-time employee, they didn't have to follow any regulations, they didn't have to provide any accommodations. Not only that, they said it would be a liability if they had someone from work come and pick me up. And when I said, well, can I at least put up a sign that I want a carpool? They said, oh no, that's solicitation, and we don't allow solicitation. So then I tried to argue with the bus service to drop me off at the place they were driving past, and that was a stone wall as well. So for almost a year, I was walking this mile of work. And it brought up this conflictual question. Am I special? Do I deserve a privilege that someone should make an accommodation and come pick me up? No, not really. But on the other hand, is it right that just because I'm blind, I can't drive? Now I have to go through this whole rigmarole and, frankly, kind of risk my life just to get to work. And every I would see my co-workers drive right past, about 10 to 20 of these. And every time they drove past, that conflict came to my mind. I'm not asking for a ride, but how would you just drive right past? I've even had people say to me, I introduced myself, hey, I'm the chaplain, and they said, oh yeah, I've seen you on the side of the road. What do you do with it? How do you respond? You know, I tried to be kind, I tried to be friendly, I intentionally went out of my way to not cause a ruckus. But yet, it's one of those things where every time that question to you, well, you know, am I inferior? Why is it that these people are just passing me by? And how does that affect my work? That even, you know, how unimportant am I is my work when the, you know, people could just pass you by? And so that seeps into your very nature. No matter how Christian you're trying to be, you're going to be a little bit angry. You know, I always thought those cold days, and so I'd say, ah, gee, it was a real cold day to be walking out there. I'd say, well, at least I got my anger to keep me warm. You know, and it wasn't, if you would ask people, it wasn't that they didn't like me. It wasn't like anybody would say, oh yeah, I think that blind guy deserves to walk on the side of the road. It wasn't, if you asked them, do you not like blind people? Of course not. But yet, it caused this deeper thing. Most of them didn't even realize it was going on. And to relate that to racial relations and things like that, when you think about the 60s and the 50s, and that wasn't that long ago, can you imagine being an adult who would drive past empty hotel after empty hotel and then end up sleeping in your car just because you were black and you weren't allowed to be in that car or sleep in those hotels? Can you imagine walking past one bus after another bus, and not be allowed to get on just because of the color of your skin? What was it? I heard a story about a woman who worked at NASA, one of the first black women to work at NASA. And she had to walk like a half mile across campus to go to the bathroom because there was no colored bathroom in her building. So when it comes to these issues of race and discrimination and oppression, you don't have to say words. You don't have to call someone out or burn a cross on their lawn in order to put someone down, in order to make someone feel less than you. And our job as Christians, our job as prophets, I believe, is to see that. This scripture today comes from a prophet, Micah. And what is a prophet? A prophet is someone who can hold human beings and God in one hand and at the same time, or one thought and at the same time, to see the divisions and the problems, and yet also how we are all one. Even though Abraham Heschel said, if you do an accurate moral estimation of our society, some are guilty, but all of us are responsible. The first duty of a prophet is to see the divides, the inequality, to look for the flaws in our society. And people will say, oh, why are you complaining about that? That's no big deal. But you can't fix a problem until you point it out. So the first duty is to find those problems. The second duty of a prophet is to heal those problems through reconciliation, through understanding, through unifying us by our common humanity and humbling us all together under the power of God. And that's what Micah is doing. In fact, in this book, in the book of Micah, you will see over and over again, there will be a condemnation of doom. Israelites, you're doing this thing wrong. You're doing this wrong. You're trampling on the poor. And then you will see the next thing is a proclamation of hope. But if you had just come together and help each other out, you'll realize the peace of God. You can lay down your swords. You won't have to study war anymore. And that's what a prophet does. On Martin Luther King Day, we celebrate Martin Luther King. And rightly so. He is a modern prophet. He wasn't a prophet for black people or for even Americans. He was walking in the tradition of old and unifying us all as a human tribe, all of us under the power of God. And now, in this time, in this place, as Christians, we are all called to be prophets. We are all called to acknowledge the injustice of the world, to point out those flaws, and then work towards healing them. Work towards reconciling them. Work towards solving those problems. Now in this scripture, it says that God doesn't want sacrifices, doesn't want lamps and worldly goods, oceans of, rivers of oil. God doesn't even want our own suffering. Some people think, oh, it's my cross to bear our suffering. No. One thing that's clear is God wants action. What does the Lord require of you? Do justice, love kindness, walk humbly with your God. Three verbs. Do, or make, or act, justly, justice. Love, mercy, kindness, and walk humbly with God. All actions, not beliefs, not dogmas, but actions. When we do justice, what is justice? Well, as I said before, it's fairness, it's rightness. Best definition, it's a hard thing to define, but I'd say justice is when something is fulfilling its purpose, it's doing the right thing at the right time. We are all doing justice when we're doing what God intended us to do. And that's what we have to work for. Whether it's sticking up for somebody else when you see them being discriminated against or being put down, whether it's going to some sort of a march or rally, whether it's contributing money to your church, or whether it's celebrating Martin Luther King Day. Doing what is just is the big picture. It's looking for the healing of the world, the coming together of nations. Then, to love kindness, or love mercy, however you want to translate it. Well, if doing justice is the big picture, loving kindness is the small thing. It's the little things. It's the helping the lady next door carry in her groceries. It's the smiling at the people on the street. You know how many people have told me at my work that just because someone smiled at them, they decided they weren't going to commit suicide. You can save a life with a smile. To do love kindness is to acknowledge the humanity in every human being and to draw them out. One of the spiritual practices I do to kind of help me with discrimination is that I often have to ask people for directions or help crossing the street or something like that, right? And normally, there's a tendency for me to look for the you know, the young college guy or the man in his suit or, you know. But I fight that every time, and I look for whoever looks like they aren't doing anything. So I won't bother. So, oh, you're just standing around, hey, can you tell me where I'm going? I shot this one guy, he was one of the Lubavitch Jews. He had this big black robe on and a black hat and a big beard. I walked up to him and I said, hey, you know, do you want me to cross this busy street? I was probably the only Gentile to talk to him that day. It was just, oh, well, yeah, sure, I can help you. And he did. Because we're all the same. And then the last, walk humbly with your God. Once again, we walk. It's another verb. To be humble is to understand another, to educate ourselves about other people, about their plights and their problems, so that we can really see what's going on, what may be different about their lives, what may be holding them back. It's amazing how much we don't know about other people, even about the people in this church. So to humble ourselves is to understand others. And then we humble ourselves and walk with our God. Now, my last point here, which I think is really interesting in Micah, is it says, what does the Lord require of you to walk humbly with your God? Well, the word Lord in the Hebrew is Yahweh, the one true God of the Jews. The word humbly with our God is Elohim, and it's a much more generic word. And in Micah 4, 5, he's talking about the vision of the future when we won't be studying more anymore, and each person will sit under their own grapevines, and they will walk in the house, they will walk with their gods, and as for me, I will walk with my Lord. And it's almost as if he's saying that you should walk with whatever God you worship. Now, whether they're Jews or, back then, of course, they have this, but Jews or Muslims or Christians or Buddhists or Hindus, you could almost say that Micah is the first interfaith gospel, or interfaith book in the Bible, because he says, I'm going to walk worship Yahweh, but as long as you're humbly walking with your God, that's okay. Just something to think of. Now, to conclude, I want to remind you that Micah said to be good prophets, we need actions, not beliefs. We need to love, do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with God. My problem work got resolved a little bit by someone volunteered to do a carpool with me. And yet, that fear of getting cast out again was still always kind of over my head. And I'm sure that affected my response, my work. So it's important for us to understand what other people are going through, so we can truly show the Christian love that we've been called to give. And when we do go through our own trials, we can use them to inspire us to do more justice, to be kinder to others, and to be humble before God. Amen.